अरे पेज डाउन ये कदा हां
एरो सर एरो
ये एरो ना एरो मिलता
है
पेज अप पेज डाउन लोगों आते
हैं हां आते सर इधर इधर आ रहे
हैं स्टार्ट ये चुप रहो
अंदर स्टार्ट
अच्छा और लंता वेंट ना ले हाउ मन के लगते हैं ओके गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल ऑफ यू विद ब्लेसिंग्स फ्रॉम गॉडेस गायत्री आई एम डॉक्टर अम्मा रेड्डी एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर ऑफ एनेस्थीसियोलॉजी Today's topic, as you know, is cardiopulmonary resuscitation. Under this, we will discuss basic and advanced life support. These are popularly called as BLS and ACLS. First of all, let us try to understand what is cardiopulmonary resuscitation. Cardio means heart, pulmonary is related to the lung. When heart and lung functions, they deteriorate suddenly or sometimes they stop completely. They immediately need to be revived. They should be brought back to their normal physiology. Certain conditions like acute heart attacks, you all heard of heart attacks, coronary syndromes and all that, drowning, suffocation incidents, in all these cases sometimes, suddenly these heart and lungs start stop functioning. So in that situation, immediately as a first aid measure, we have to resuscitate them without wasting time. It should be done within 5 minutes, as early as possible. The more you delay, the more will be the risk for the patient. So sometimes these things can happen in the hospital or out of the hospital. So the trained people may not be available on the spot. That is why these basic BLS and ACLS procedures are taught to even non-medical people, whosoever is interested to learn, so that immediately they can attend to those patients. So to discuss what steps are to be taken, suppose suddenly you find a person lying unconscious and what to do immediately. So these things will be taught to you in a systematic manner. So before we actually go to discuss those things, just the historical aspects we will discuss. The importance given to these BLS and ACLS started from 1966. If you go into the history, even in biblical times, there are reports of reviving stopped heart and lung functions. But recently, in 1966, National Academy of Sciences, National Research Council Conference, this is in USA, this conference has generated consensus standards. That is, several scientists from several countries, they conducted a meeting. They discussed based on available evidence and come to a list of steps to be followed in these cases. These are called consensus standards. From that time, several conferences have reviewed the practice of CPR. The 2010 American Heart Association guidelines for cardiopulmonary resuscitation and emergency cardiovascular care, they actually represent the third internationally recognized resuscitation guidelines. The main partners who took part in this is American Heart Association and European Resuscitation Council. There are other countries also, but they have come up with the standard guidelines to be followed. These are actually 2010 American Heart Association guidelines. They are universally followed all over the world. These were again updated in 2015. So like that, they goes on updation and increase money. Improving the standards based on available evidence. They do several randomized trials with patients, do a lot of research on animals. Based on these findings, they go on improving these standard protocols. So under basic life, we will discuss this topic under two heads, basic life support and advanced cardiac life support. Basic life support is basic life-saving interventions for patients in respiratory and cardiac distress when you don't have any equipment or drugs with you. Whatever is available with you on the spot, you do the interventions. These are very simple. Only thing is you should be well conversant with this order of the things to be done. Under this, we discuss CPR for adults, CPR for children, CPR for infants, choking interventions for adults and children, choking intervention for infants. These are important even for us, for our domestic use, for friends, and even in our home setup. So must give importance for these things. Both basic life support and advanced cardiac life support. ACLS. ACLS requires some equipments and some medicines, usually in hospital setup or in ambulances which are equipped with these things. Both are, there is widespread acceptance of both these procedures. There are several, the American Heart Association comes with special classes, coaching classes for BLS and ACLS and provide certification courses. So those interested can go to one of these courses and they will teach you both practical methods as well as theory. So now coming to the sudden cardiac arrest. Suppose the heart suddenly stops functioning, what happens? The anterograde systemic blood flow continues. That is the flow from the left ventricle and right ventricle continues for some time. From the left ventricle, it grows until the pressure gradient between aorta and right heart structures reach equilibrium, until they become equated. Normally, left ventricle has a higher pressure than right atrium. So till these two pressures equalize, some amount of flow continues. Similarly, in the pulmonary side, anterograde pulmonary flow between pulmonary artery and left atrium also continues for some time, that is only for a few minutes. When these two pressure gradients equilibrate, approximately it takes 5 minutes, coronary perfusion and cerebral blood flow stop. So that means this is equal to death of the patient. Systemic and coronary blood flow during CPR is dependent on effective chest compressions. During that period, suppose suddenly there is a stoppage of the heart. For a few minutes, we can sustain that circulation by doing effective chest compressions. We will tell you in a later slides how to do these compressions and all that. And there is also an important factor is venous blood return. Blood should return to the heart and the heart should be able to pump some amount of blood to make the individual survive. Cardiac output during CPR with effective uninterrupted chest compressions is 25% to 30% of normal. Even with the best of compressions, we cannot restore complete circulation. We can do up to 25% to 30%. Even this is sufficient to keep the heart and brain alive for a few minutes. Then subsequent interventions by advanced cardiac life support and other means will make the individual survive. In cardiac arrest, except in hypoxic causes, that is drowning and suffocation, oxygen content in the lung is usually sufficient for maintaining acceptable arterial oxygen content. So excepting these two conditions, like asphyxiating conditions, oxygen content in the blood is sufficient. So you need not worry about the oxygen content. That means you don't have to worry much about providing breathing, rescue breaths. More important is initiating chest compressions. That is, you must make sure that blood flows. So that is why the emphasis is given more on initiating chest compressions. Earlier, the emphasis was on providing breathing. Airway breathing and circulation was the teaching. A, B, C, they used to say. Now the things have changed. C has come forward. It is now capped. Circulation, airway and breathing. That is because in the initial parts, oxygen content in the lung, in the blood is sufficient for maintaining few minutes of life. So blood flow should be made flowing, that is by initiating compressions. Blood flow rather than arterial oxygen content is the limiting factor for oxygen delivery to coronary, cerebral and systemic circulations. Basic life support, essential steps in basic life support are early recognition of medical emergency. First of all, you have to recognize that it is a medical emergency and we have to act. How to recognize that we will teach now. Then next step is activation of emergency response system. Emergency response system, we have ambulance systems, we can ring up them. They have all equipment in their ambulances, they arrive on the spot. If this incident happens outside the hospital. Even inside the hospital also, you have activating systems, code blue, something like that, and you ring an alarm, so that all experts will come to the scene of accident and provide necessary help. Interventions made in response to sudden cardiac arrest, heart attack, stroke, and foreign body airway obstruction. These are usually the causes where we need to act. In basic BLS, there is no equipment available, as I have already told. But AED is made available nowadays, especially in Western countries. They have always, AED is automatic external defibrillator. It provides an electric shock to the heart. And defibrillation, providing electric shock by AED is considered to be a very essential step. In Western countries, almost in all places like airports, schools, shopping centers, hospitals, casinos, everywhere this AED is made available and almost all are trained about how to use and all that. These AEDs are very easy to use. This ease of application, very easy to apply the pads. Then they automatically, cardiac rhythm analysis they do on their own and they administer shock if shock is required. So because they are very easy to use, these equipments are made available, but in our country, we are lagging behind. Now this I have already told you, airway breathing circulation was the earlier mnemonic part. That is airway first, breathing then and circulation, but now it is replaced. Circulation, airway, breathing, please remember. CAB, this is the sequence. First importance should be given to circulation, then airway and breathing. This is both for adults and children resuscitation. So this is the algorithm, that is our flow chart, step-by-step procedure to be followed. This is a case of, say, some, for example, some adult or a child is seen lying unconscious at out of the hospital in some spot. What to, how to approach and what to do. First, verify scene safety, first step. You see whether he is in a safe place or not. Suppose a road accident, he is lying in the middle of the road. So you can't leave him like that, you bring him aside of the road. Like that, if some electric wires or something is there, you should ensure that they will not cause harm to this patient. Also, since you are trying to resuscitate, you also maybe get hurt. That is scene safety. Then next step is, victim is unresponsive. Whether he is responding or not. Shout, how you will do it? You just shake him up, call, hello mister, how are you? How do you do? What is your name? Like that, you put some question or then find out whether he is responding or not. If he is not responding, you shout for nearby help. Then activate emergency response system. Nowadays, everybody is having mobiles. You can call by your mobile emergency system. And also call for AED if the AED is available nearby. Then look for breathing, whether he is breathing or not. Sometimes the patient may be gasping. That is not to be considered as breathing. And also check for pulse simultaneously. Will tell you how to check pulse and all that. And you should not take much time for doing all this. It should be less than 10 seconds only. Here saving time is very, very important. Then in this case, if the patient is not having breathing, but has a pulse, he is not breathing, but he is having pulse, then you have to provide rescue breaths. You provide one breath every 5 to 6 seconds or 10 to 12 breaths per minute. This how to provide these things we will come in the later slides. Activate emergency response system if you have not done earlier. Continue rescue breathing and check pulse about every 2 minutes. Begins, if pulse is not there, you have to go for CPR. If opioid, possible opioid overdose is suspected, you can administer naloxone if that is available. Then another setting, normal breathing, he has pulse, he is breathing normally and he is having pulse also. There is nothing much to do here, only monitor until emergency responders arrive. You just observe him and wait for the ACLS providers to come. In third scenario, there is no breathing or only gasping. Gasping also considered as no breathing, no pulse. He doesn't have a pulse. He is also not breathing. So this is a situation where he needs a CPR, cardiopulmonary resuscitation. How to start is begin cycles of 30 compressions and 2 breaths. Chest compressions, 30 compressions followed by 2 breaths. Use AED as soon as it is available. Automated external defibrillators, if it is available, as soon as it comes, it should be used. Because in cardiac fibrillations and ventricular tachycardia, generally these are the conditions which produce unconsciousness and sudden collapse. These two conditions, defibrillation is very, very important, essential. The earlier you do it, the better is the prognosis for the patient. AED arise, you attach the AED to the patient. The AED will do the job, everything. It checks the rhythm, it tells you whether it is a shockable rhythm or not. If it is shockable, it gives you, the only thing you have to power the button, give one shock. Immediately after that, resume CPR for about 2 minutes. And after 2 minutes, the machine will again prompt you. It will analyze the rhythm and say whether it is shockable rhythm or not. Like this, you continue till the ACLS providers come. If it is not a shockable rhythm, non-shockable, if the AED tells rhythm not shock not required, you have to resume CPR for about 2 minutes. Every 2 minutes, AED checks the rhythm and tells you whether it is shockable or not shockable. And so this cycle continues. This is how you continue till either the patient regains his consciousness or advanced cardiac life support team members or some emergency ambulance, something comes for you to your rescue. This is basically the steps of BLS, basic life support. So these are a few points about the BLS. Lay rescuers and healthcare professionals, they misinterpret agonal gasping respirations as spontaneous ventilation and fail to recognize absence of pulse early. So there is no much emphasis is not provided on feeling the pulse. In case of lay rescuers, they may not be able to recognize the pulse. So without wasting time, you start with chest compressions. They must be immediately initiated. This I already told you, 30 chest compressions at a rate of 100 per minute. And chest compressions should not be interrupted, minimal interruption. And this is followed by 2 rescue breaths. This is same for adults as well as children. There is a minor difference that I will tell in the later slides. This compression must be push hard and push fast. You must push hard with much required force, and it should be fast because you have to complete 100 to 120 compressions. Then chest compression should be at least 2 inches deep. Chest bone, sternum should depress by 5 centimeters, 2 inches. In children also, chest compression should be 1/3 the depth of the thorax, anteroposterior diameter. In bigger children, it is almost same as adults. In infants, it is 4 centimeters. Interruptions in chest compressions negatively affect coronary and cerebral perfusion and return of spontaneous circulation. ROS is return of spontaneous circulation. So this I already told, limiting interruptions in chest compressions. Single and 2-person CPR, the recommendation is compression ventilation ratio of 30:2. CPR is performed until spontaneous circulation returns or the patient is pronounced dead. Compression only resuscitation. This is one thing recently introduced. Sometimes some people, they may not be much interested to do mouth to mouth breathing, or they may not be well trained in performing these mouth to mouth breathing, and they hesitate to provide resuscitation. For them, you can ask them to perform only compressions. So maybe potential. So this is what is called compression only resuscitation. That is without doing any respiratory assistance. You can just start with chest compressions. Even that will help, especially in the situation of there is now COVID cases and all, people may hesitate to do mouth to mouth respiration. So for them this will help. However, for the best chance of survival, conventional CPR is superior to compression only superior. But this is something is better than nothing. Instead of doing nothing, compression only will help a little. Physiological considerations, how the circulation improves during CPR. There are two mechanisms, cardiac pump mechanism and thoracic pump mechanism. Cardiac pump mechanism is blood was thought to be ejected as a direct result of actual compression of the heart between the sternum and vertebral column. Because of the compression pressure, blood is pumped out of the heart. Another theory is thoracic pump mechanism. This is intrathoracic pressure rises by depression of the sternum. That will also indirectly put pressure on the heart and cause blood flow. So this is table is there. Here it explains a few differences between CPR in adults, children and infants. And CPR in newborns is not discussed in our topic today. Adults and adolescents in one group. Children, age 1 year to puberty, they are considered as children. Infants are age less than 1 year, excluding newborns. Newborns, as I told you, we are not discussing. So the differences I will tell you. Scene safety is same for all. Make sure environment is safe for rescuers and victim. Recognition of cardiac arrest is the second step. Check for responsiveness. If no breathing or only gasping, that is no normal breathing. No definite pulse. All these things to be done within 10 seconds. Breathing and pulse check can be performed simultaneously. And if it is not there, it indicates that CPR or basic life support measures are required. Activation of emergency response system. If you are alone, where you don't have any mobile, leave the victim to activate emergency response system. Get the AED before beginning CPR. Otherwise, you can, if somebody else is there to help you, you can send him to bring AED. Whereas in children and infants, there is a small difference. In witnessed collapse means you have seen the child collapsing right in front of your eyes. In that case, you follow the steps of the adults. Immediately, you need not do any compressions. You call for AED. Then you start the CPR. If it is unwitnessed collapse, that means child is lying unconscious. You don't know how long he is there like that. In that case, you have to give 2 minutes of CPR before you go for AED or calling emergency response system. That is the difference. In unwitnessed collapse, that is a patient whom you have not seen him collapsing, first you have to give 2 minutes CPR, then go for emergency. It is a witness thing, if you have seen the child falling down, then you have to. Call for emergency first, then do the CPR. This is another important difference. Compression ventilation ratio without advanced airway. Compression and ventilation ratio is whether one rescuer or two rescuer, it is 30:2. Rescuer means sometimes a team members, 3-4 members also may be available. These are all people are all called rescuers. If one or two, irrespective of the number, 30:2 in case of adults. Whereas in children and infants, if it is single rescuer, 30:2 as in adults. But if there are two or more rescuers, so 15:2 is the compression ventilation ratio. This is the main difference between BLS for adults and children and infants. be one point, and there is another small point. Otherwise, rest of the thing is all same. So I will repeat again. Compression ventilation ratio without advanced airway. In adults, it is 30:2, whether it is one or two rescuers. Whereas in children and infants, if it is one rescuer, it is 30:2. If two or more rescuers, it is 15:2. Compression ventilation ratio with advanced airway, that means if there is an endotracheal tube or a LMA or supraglottic airways are placed, in that case, continuous compressions at a rate of 100 to 120, one breath every 6 seconds or 10 breaths per minute. Compression rate same in all, 100 to 120 per minute. Compression depth at least 2 inches, 5 centimeters in adults. In children, 1/3 AP diameter of the chest, it is 2 inches, same as adults. In infants, 1/3 AP diameter of the chest, 1.5 inches, that is 4 centimeters. This is the small difference. An infant's chest depression should be 4 centimeters. Hand placement. In adults, 2 hands, lower half of the breastbone. In children also, if they are slightly bigger, adult proportion, they can use 2 hands. Or if they are little small, you can use 1 hand. It's same, lower half of the breastbone. In infants, if it is one rescuer, 2 fingers in the center of the chest, just below the nipple line. If 2 or more rescuers, 2 thumb encircling hands in the center of the chest, just below the nipple line. These I will show the diagrams in later slides. Chest recoil. Allow full recoil of the chest after each compression. Do not lean on the chest after each compression. After compression, you should allow the chest to rise again before you give another compression. Minimum interruptions. Limit interruptions in chest compressions to less than 10 seconds. This table, upper part almost same as previous one. The only thing is ventilation when rescuer is untrained or is trained but not proficient. If he is not efficient in providing respirations, you can use compression only, CPR. Ventilation with advanced airway, that is healthcare providers who are experts in providing endotracheal intubation or laryngeal mask or laryngeal tubes. One breath every 6 to 8 seconds, 8 to 10 breaths per minute. Asynchronous with chest compressions. You need not to bother for chest come away. Ask the compressor to stop. You can provide your respirations because airway is there. There should be visible chest rise. When you provide breaths, chest should rise. That is indication that you are adequately ventilating him. Then defibrillation. Attach and use AED as soon as available. Minimize interruptions in chest compressions before and after shock. Resume CPR. Beginning with compressions immediately. So all the things are same, only thing, 1 or 2 minor points. So there were several modifications to standard CPR by incorporating mechanical adjuncts like interposed abdominal compressions. There were mechanical devices to provide chest compression, suction devices, but none of them are proved to be better than normal CPR. So, CPR, regardless of the mechanism of blood flow, it must be known that it is a temporary intervention. It needs rapid supplementation with ACLS is important. It is only temporary. Immediately, as soon as possible, the patient should be taken to an advanced center. Most critical in the BLS is rapid defibrillation. No device other than defibrillator has been associated with consistently improved survival from cardiac arrest. So here, the most frequent cardiac rhythm responsible for witnessed cardiac arrest in adults is ventricular fibrillation. We lay people call it as heart attack. Ventricular fibrillation is highly metabolically active state. the ventricular muscle fibers, they go on fibrillating, that is asynchronous irregular contraction. They use a lot of myocardial energy, depleting myocardial stores of oxygen and substrates. These chest compressions, which we provide in BLS, it delivers oxygen and energy substrates to the myocardium. It prolongs the duration of ventricular fibrillation but cannot convert arrhythmia to organized rhythm. So the most essential part is only defibrillation. Defibrillation, what is defibrillation? It is the process of delivering an electrical current between two electrical plates placed on the chest with sufficient current passing through the myocardium to restore an organized cardiac rhythm. Successful termination of ventricular fibrillation requires effective chest compressions and prompt defibrillation. This is very, very vital. Successful termination of ventricular fibrillation. What are required is effective chest compressions and prompt defibrillation. So I will tell something briefly about defibrillation equipments, because the defibrillator is the most essential and vital equipment. Automated external defibrillators and manual defibrillators. The automated is, which I already told you, they automatically analyze the rhythm and deliver the shock. Manual defibrillation, you have to read the machine's prompts and then follow it. So as per AHA recommendations, early defibrillation AED is part of BLS training. Then there is also what is called a public access defibrillation. In advanced countries, even lay people are trained with defibrillation. So there they make it available, the machine, and anybody can use it. So this I have already told you, AED. The AED application, this is important. Even during AED application, when the AED is doing rhythm analysis, minimal in chest compression should be continued. While applying pads, during rhythm analysis, you should clear and you should not do it. But while applying pads and while bringing the AED, during that time, you should not stop compressions. The minimal interruption of chest compressions should happen. So this is a brief history of development of defibrillators. First microprocessor based AED was introduced in 1986. The AEDs, they used three successive non-escalating 180 joule monophasic damped waveform shocks. Non-escalating means 180 joules, next shock also 180 joules, like that, not increasing it. So in defibrillation technology, there were advances. Conversion from monophasic to biphasic defibrillator waveforms. Biphasic defibrillators are advanced machines than monophasic. They are much better. Because of this biphasic defibrillators, the machine size has become small. They are lighter units with more accurate rhythm analysis. So a manual defibrillator, if you activate, it also gives voice prompts like the AEDs. The manual defibrillator should be managed with protocol identical to current AED protocols. Uninterrupted chest compression should be delivered while defibrillator pads are being applied and for periods when rhythm analysis is not occurring. Chest compressions are immediately resumed after shock delivery. Cardiac rhythm is reanalyzed as indicated after 2 minutes of chest compressions. Defibrillation is attempted only for ventricular fibrillation and rapid ventricular tachycardia. If a monophasic defibrillator is available, defibrillation energy should begin at high energy levels, 300 to 360 for monophasic defibrillators. For biphasic, the energy is 150, 120, like that. Biphasic defibrillation, they deliver energy first in one direction and then in a reversed for the durational impulse. Two types of biphasic waveforms are used in modern AEDs, biphasic truncated and rectilinear biphasic. this rectilinear biphasic is the most advanced. And one advanced feature in this biphasic defibrillators is impedance compensation. They are non-escalating, low-energy biphasic waveforms. Here you use 150 joules, whereas monophasic I told you is 360. They are more successful in terminating ventricular fibrillation than are traditional escalating energy monophasic waveforms, 200 to 300 joules in monophasic. In biphasic, it is less 150. Less energy means less damage to the cardiac tissue. There also impedance compensation is another feature. It allows the defibrillator to change waveform morphologic characteristics based upon impedance measured during shock delivery. Impedance is because of thoracic tissue. In adults, it is nearly 70 to 80 ohms. The current has to pass through the chest wall, then through the myocardium. So this chest wall offers some resistance. This resistance is in adults 70 to 80 ohms. These machines, they calculate this resistance and accordingly adjust the delivered shock energy. If the delivered shock energy is not sufficient, the myocardium will not be reverted back to normal mode. If it is more, it may damage the heart. So that is why this impedance compensation is a safety feature. Biphasic defibrillation waveforms and impedance compensation together allow effective defibrillation at lower energies than with monophasic non-impedance compensated waveforms. So this is a phone to call for emergency, activating emergency system. This is the AED. In Western countries, they keep it in almost all public access places, airports, shops, sporting areas and all that. This is how the pads are applied. One is below the right collarbone, another left below the left nipple. Then there are a few points about use of an AED. First of all, power on the AED. This is the power button. This is how the machine looks. You switch on this button. Apply pads to the victim's bare chest. These two pads are applied. This is below the right collarbone, below the left nipple. Plug the pads into the AED. These two points are plugged into the AED machine. Clear the victim and allow it to analyze. After you do it, then you say clear. Means you should, nobody should be touching the patient. Then if shock is advised, the machine will analyze rhythm and says it is shockable rhythm. Shock is required, it says. Clear the victim again and press the shock button. Before you press the shock button, you should make sure that nobody is touching the patient or any of his body parts or anything, because that will deliver shock to the resuscitators. Then you deliver the button. Continue chest. Then immediately you continue chest compressions. Every 2 minutes, the AED will repeat the above steps. After 2 minutes, the machine says, checking the rhythm. Then again you clear, allow the machine to check the rhythm. Then shock, if shock is indicated, you give the shock. So if no one is touching the patient, if shock is indicated, and the machine says shock is indicated, manual contact. Generally they say clear, I am clear, you are clear. That means you ask your colleagues who are helping you to clear, not to touch the patient. Press the shock button when the providers are clear of the patient. Resume 5 cycles of CPR. If rhythm is not shockable, that is the machine says shock is not required, not shockable rhythm, initiate 5 cycles of CPR. Recheck the rhythm at the end of 5 cycles of CPR. Then about airway management and ventilation in cardiac arrest. Till now we discussed about circulation part, CAB, circulation. Now we will discuss AB, airway and breathing, ventilation. First you have to make the airway clear. To make it, the head tilt, chin lift maneuver is recommended for initial airway control in most circumstances. Head tilt and chin lift, how it is done, we will show in the slides. The main reason for blockage of the airway is the epiglottis. because of its ligamentous attachments to thyroid bone, epiglottis can be lifted by manual maneuvers that anteriorly displace the thyroid bone. You can also use head tilt jaw thrust maneuver, but it should not be used when suspected cervical fractures. When rescue breathing is indicated for an individual in cardiac arrest, 2 breaths are delivered after 30 chest compressions during 1 and 2% CPR. So this I have already told in 2010 AHA guidelines. Untrained rescuers need not provide rescue breaths. They are only advised to provide uninterrupted chest compressions. Now, while providing rescue breaths, you should provide with only enough force, not much force to be used, and volume, tidal volume, that is the amount of air you breathe into the patient. It also should be optimal. It should not be more, but it should cause the chest rise. Hyperventilation should be avoided. Excessive ventilation force or tidal volume overcomes. If you provide excessive ventilation, that is, you give a more tidal volume or with more force if you blow in, that causes esophageal opening pressure, overcomes it, and gastric inflation. Air gets into the stomach and stomach contents will regurgitate and it may produce aspiration. They may patient may drown in his secretions. And if the intrathoracic pressure increases, it also reduces the venous return. If there is no blood to the heart, if the blood doesn't return to the heart, it cannot pump out. So excess pressure has this disadvantage. If tracheal intubation can be done by expert, then ventilation can occur at a rate of 8 to 10 breaths per minute with small tidal volume. Chest compressions should be only minimally interrupted and for provision of rescue breaths. Most important is compressions, so they should not be stopped for long periods. During the first few minutes after the onset of cardiac arrest, chest compressions are the priority intervention. If cardiac arrest is due to asphyxia, drowning, or suffocation, ventilation must be provided before chest compressions. Advanced airway placement is no longer a priority. Attempts to place endotracheal intubation cause interruptions in chest compressions. Unless you are an expert, you should not try for putting endotracheal tubes or laryngeal mass or other laryngeal tubes, etc. So this is how you check for the carotid pulse. Put the patient supine on a hard flat surface. Check the patient for a carotid pulse for 5 to 10 seconds. Don't take much time. And from the, this is how you have to check the carotid pulse. Place, this is how to provide the compressions. Place your palms midline, one over the other, on the lower one third of patient's sternum between nipples. Lock your arms. Using two arms, press to a depth of 2 inches, 5 centimeters on the patient's chest. Press hard and fast. Allow for chest recoil with each compression. One cycle of adult CPR is 30 chest compressions to 2 rescue breaths. So this is how to place the hands and provide the chest compressions. See, below the lower part of the sternum, 2 hands locked position. And the hand should be straight and the whole body weight should be put on the chest so that there is sufficient depression of the sternum. If there are 2 providers, switch roles between compressor and rescue breather every 5 cycles, because chest compressions is a very tiring process. One cannot continue more than 2 minutes. So at every completion of every 5 cycles, the rescuers, they should change positions. The one who is giving breathing will come to us as a compressor. Compressor will come to the breathing side. So this is the initial part of assessment. The patient is not breathing or is inadequately. Rescue breathing should be started. Here he explains how to provide rescue breathing. If use a barrier device if available, pinch the patient's nose, make seal using your mouth over the mouth of the patient, or if you have a pocket mask or bag mask, you can use it. These pocket masks, they are used in Western countries. They carry with them, so in they use it. These are more comfortable to use. Each rescue breath should last approximately 1 second. Watch for chest rise. Allow time for the air to exhale from the patient. This is how to provide the mouth-to-mouth breathing. And this is with bag and mask ventilation. This is in a hospital setting. If this is available, it is more comfortable way of doing and a better way. But in out of the hospital circumstances, only this is the only way. So during normal CPR without an advanced airway, provide approximately 6 to 8 rescue breaths per minute. If there is an advanced airway, that is an endotracheal tube or laryngeal mask airway, provide 10 rescue breaths, one breath every 6 seconds. You need not pause chest compressions if there is an advanced airway. If patient has a pulse, no CPR is required. Only rescue breaths are provided. After the patient, if he recovers, then you should put him in recovery position. This is lateral recumbent or 3/4 prone position. It is used to maintain a patient airway in unconscious person. Place the patient close to a true lateral position with the head dependent to allow fluid to drain. Assure the position is stable. Avoid pressure of the chest that could impair breathing. Position the patient in such a way that it allows turning them into their back easily. This is the recovery position. If there is cervical spine injury, you should be careful. This is the chain of survival. Is there are 5 essential all these 5 form a chain. If there is a break in any one of these, all our efforts will go waste. First thing is immediate recognition of cardiac arrest and activation of emergency response system. This is the first thing. Next is early CPR with emphasis on chest compressions, rapid defibrillation, effective advanced life support. This is ambulance service and care, taking the patient to the nearest cardiac center. And after that also there is a lot to be done. Integrated post cardiac arrest care. This happens in advanced care centers and hospitals. So all these five, they should have good cooperation and coordination. If there is a break in any one of them, the patient will not survive. So these are for advanced users. An experienced person is available and endotracheal intubation is done, you can go for bag valve mask ventilation, or you can use laryngeal mask airway. These are all latest airways coming up. These devices do not require visualization. They can be inserted without interrupting chest compressions. If these equipments like endotracheal tube or laryngeal masks are there, you can measure the end-tidal carbon dioxide. This is a very important new concept now. Partial pressure of carbon dioxide in the expired air. It is called PETCO2. PETCO2. Partial pressure of end-tidal carbon dioxide. It is a sign of breathing. Patient is actually breathing. Lung is getting perfused. Carbon dioxide is getting eliminated. That means breathing is taking place properly. The monitoring is a sure sign that he is breathing. Once an advanced airway is inserted, its placement must be confirmed. This end-tidal carbon dioxide monitoring, it is also used for confirming verification of the tracheal tube that it is in the lung. And other means are by seeing breath sounds. You can see the chest rise if the breathing is taking place properly. and this carbon dioxide, as I've already told. Continuous monitoring of PET CO2, partial pressure of entitled carbon dioxide, is recommended during resuscitation attempts to ensure that airway placement is secure, to guide compression quality. And if you are not providing proper compression, this will fall. And to detect ROS. ROS is return of spontaneous circulation. During your resuscitation efforts, whether patient has developed his normal pulse and respiration, this also can be detected with this PET2CO2. Once the patient regains his pulse and starts breathing, there will be abrupt rise of PET2CO2 levels. This clearly shows that patient has recovered. So this 2010 AHA guidelines for CPR and ECC, they endorse PET2CO2 monitoring as a class 1 recommendation for adults with SCA with an endotracheal tube or supraglottic airway in place. Now this is about resuscitation in infant. The steps are almost the same as in adults, except a few minor differences. You assess to make sure scene is safe, the same, assess unresponsiveness. This is done by lightly shaking or tapping the infant's foot. Look at the chest and torso for movement and normal breathing. If the infant is unresponsive, and if there is only one provider and collapse is unwitnessed, that means you have not seen, first do 2 minutes of CPR, then call for emergency. If there is only one provider and collapse is witnessed, here you call emergency and bring an AED. And if there are two providers, you can, one will go for calling this emergency, second will start CPR. For infant, checking of pulse, brachial or femoral pulse, and this should not be done for more than 10 seconds. For infants, breath rate is 12 to 20 per minute. And recheck pulse every 2 minutes. This is the thing, femoral and brachial. If the infant does not have a pulse, begin 5 cycles of CPR. This CPR, if there is one provider, start with chest compressions. Provide 100 to 120 compressions per minute. Place 2 fingers on the sternum of the lower chest, one between the nipple line and the other 1 centimeter below. 1 cycle is 30 chest compressions to rescue breaths. This is in case of one provider. If there are 2 providers, this is done by encircling the infant's torso with both hands, with both thumbs pointing cephalic position 1 centimeter below nipples. This diagram I will show you. Here 1 cycle is 50 chest compressions to 2 rescue breaths. This is one person, one rescuer, 2 fingers below the nipple line in the chest compressions he is doing. This is when 2 rescuers are there for infants. One is 2 hands encircling the chest, both the thumbs in the lower part of the sternum, and he will provide the compressions. This is with back mask ventilation. Second rescuer is giving the respirations. Chest compression should be at least 1.5 inches or 1/3 the depth of infant's chest. Rest of things the same, press hard and fast, allow for full chest recoil, only allow minimal interruptions. If you have 2 providers, switch roles between compressor and rescue breathers every 2 minutes. Airway, in the event of an unwitnessed collapse, drowning or trauma, this use jaw thrust maneuver. This is used when cervical injuries can be ruled out. Place your thumbs on the upper cheek bones of the infant. Place your fingers on the lower rami of the jaw. Provide anterior pressure to advance the jaw forward. In the event of witnessed collapse and there is reason to suspect cervical spine injury, if there is cervical spine injury, you should not interfere much with the patient because that may damage the spine and cause more harm. So there you use only head tilt, chin lift maneuver. Only head tilt, and this will show in the next diagram. Place your palm on the patient's forehead and apply pressure to tilt the head backward. Place the fingers of your other hand under the mental protuberance of the chin and pull the chin forward. This is how it is done. Place one hand here on the forehead, depress it down, and here you elevate the chin. So this will open the airway. Breathing. If the abnormal breathing, if the patient is not breathing, infant has adequate breathing, you continue to assist. You place him in the recovery position. If the infant is not breathing or is inadequately breathing, and if the infant has a pulse, only rescue breaths are provided. This I have already told you. You can use a barrier device if it is available. Make a seal using your mouth over the mouth and nose of the patient. In small infants, both mouth and nose can be included, resuscitator's mouth. Each rescue breath should be small and last approximately 1 second. You must observe for rising of the chest. It is an indication that lungs are getting inflated. Allow time for the air to expel from the patient. Mouth to mouth or nose technique. To give breaths to a child, use mouth to mouth technique. Make sure that the breaths are effective. Each breath should take about 1 second. This I already told. If there is no adequate breathing during these procedures, it means that there is some obstruction and you have not properly put the ceiling. You reposition the head, make a better seal and try again. So this is how the breathing is done. 12 to 20 rescue breaths. During normal CPR with an advanced airway, provide 12 to 20 rescue breaths per minute. Recovery position. Cradle the infant with the infant head tilted downward and slightly to the side. If the patient recovers, you can put him in the recovery position. This I already discussed. This slide also need not be discussed because we have already discussed the differences between adults and infants. Same things here. So I'm skipping this. In children AED placement, there is a small difference. Age greater than 8 years, use adult AED. If the child is more than 8 years, you can use the adult AED. If age 1 to 8 years, use pediatric pads. These AEDs have pediatric pads, you can use them. Otherwise, if you can use adult pads. Age less than 1 year, use only if manufacturer instructions indicate its use in children. This is the algorithm for pediatric cardiac arrest algorithm. This also need not be discussed much. All these things we have already discussed. Assessing for skin safety, whether he is unresponsive, shout for help, activate this, that. If there is no breathing, all these things are same. Only thing, the difference I have already told you in the CPR. If one rescuer, begin cycles of 30 compressions and 2 breaths. If use 15:2 ratio if second rescuer arrives. Use AED as soon as it arrives. Otherwise, rest of all things already we have discussed in BLS algorithm for adults. So there are some injuries can happen during CPR if not properly done. Rib fractures can happen, laceration related to tip of the sternum. Even liver, lungs, spleen, eyes may be damaged. Aspiration can occur. Next, once a patient survives BLS, he should be further managed with ACLS, both in adults and children. Now we'll discuss something about choking in adults to child ever 1 year old. In choking, universal signal for choking. Patient has both hands wrapped around the base of the throat, like this. With complete airway obstruction, child is unable to speak, cry, or provide any sounds. The patient is confused, weak, obtended, loss of sensations, and cyanotic. Partial airway obstruction may result in stridor or a high-pitched audible noise. Partial airway obstruction may allow for productive cough or allow the patient to speak. If there is a partial obstruction, we should not much interfere, only encourage him to vomit the structure that is obstructing the throat. Get the patient's attention and ask them if they are choking and support him. Sometimes that will come out. So assess for signs and symptoms. Partial airway, do not attempt Heimlich maneuver. If complete airway obstruction, if there is one provider, immediately call the emergency response team. Attempt Heimlich maneuver. How it is done? Stand directly behind the child or adult. Place both of your arms around patient's waist. Make a fist with one hand and grab the fist with the opposite hand. Position the thumb end of the fisted hand immediately above the patient's navel. It should be ample distance away from zippered process. This is important. You should not include zippered, otherwise it will break. Perform fast upward and inward diaphragmatic abdominal thrusts. Until obstruction is removed. If during this process patient becomes unconscious, initiate CPR. Before attempting rescue breaths during normal CPR, assess airway, removing any visually present obstruction. If it is visually present and easily removed only, you have to attempt. Otherwise, don't use blind finger sweeps. That is when it is not completely visualized. Your attempts may push it inside rather than remove it. This also same for child also, there is not much difference. Now how to do the Heimlich type maneuvers in children. Lay infant's face and torso down on forearm with chest being supported by your palm and their head and neck by your fingers. Tilt the infant's body at 30 degree angle, head downwards. Use your thigh or other object for support. You provide interventional chest thrusts. Next diagram will clear the things. Just I will draw you. This is how you take the child in your hand and press with your fingers in the middle of the sternum lower part. And by forceful thrust, the foreign body may come out. And this is the back blows, interventional back blows. After doing this previous one attempt, then you can turn the patient, that infant, in this position. This is supported on his thigh. With the hand, he is holding the head and thumb. Five rapid forceful blows using flat palm on the infant's back between the two scapula here. Then again reposition. If the body, foreign body is not removed, you turn him back and attempt. Rotate the infant's face up, head downward to the opposite arm. If it becomes unconscious during the process, you have to do CPR. This is same already discussed in pregnant women. This is how you do the Heimlich maneuver. So this completes the basic life support. Now we will discuss about advanced cardiac life support. Advanced cardiac life support is in hospitals or in centers where other equipment is available, drugs, equipment, manpower, trained staff, other consultants, etc., all available. In these places, you follow these things. This is quite a complex thing. CPR almost invariably necessitates rapid progression to ACLS. So under this, you have to various rhythms you have to analyze. Supraventricular bradyarrhythmias, supraventricular tachyarrhythmias, ventricular wide complex tachyarrhythmias, ventricular bradyarrhythmias. These require some understanding of the cardiac physiology and other rhythm disturbances. So we are not going to discuss all these things. Most important is ventricular fibrillation, which causes sudden cardiac arrest. That and pulseless ventricular tachycardia and ventricular fibrillation. These two things only we will discuss under ACLS. These rhythms and all I am not discussing because time doesn't permit and it is a bit complex. So pulseless ventricular tachycardia and ventricular fibrillation. These two are for therapeutic purposes considered same lethal entity, requiring same interventions. For both of them, what is required is prompt defibrillation. These arrhythmias are most treatable and yield greatest likelihood of immediate and long-term survival. So for them, early defibrillation is most important. Pharmacological interventions are not that important. A period of chest compression before defibrillation is not recommended in 2010 AHA guidelines. If a monophasic defibrillator is available, single 360 joule shock should be delivered. Monophasic, in our setup mostly we have only this. With biphasic defibrillators, truncated exponential waveforms should use 150 to 200 joules. These three things you can remember. Monophasic defibrillator, 360 joules. Biphasic, truncated exponential waveforms, 150 to 200 joules per first shock. Energy setting for rectilinear, these are the most modern. Rectilinear, these are also biphasic waveforms. Biphasic waveforms, two types are there. Biphasic truncated, biphasic rectilinear. They use less energy, 120 joules, and these are most effective. Supposing the rescuer is not familiar with the recommendations of the manufacturer, the maximal available energy on the machine can be used. But this is only a last resort. Chest compression should be immediately resumed after delivering shock and continued for 2 minutes before reassessing the underlying cardiac rhythm. All biphasic defibrillators available today are impedance compensated and they adjust the delivered dose of energy in response to the measured transthoracic impedance. Defibrillation energy should be increased until ventricular fibrillation is terminated. If ROS has not occurred, ROS means return of spontaneous circulation, patient becoming conscious and recovering respiratory and cardiac function. If it has not occurred after defibrillator attempts, then 5 cycles of CPR consisting of 30 to ventilation should be performed before cardiac rhythm analysis, and this cycle goes on. Defibrillate, provide compressions. Till somebody comes, advanced cardiac support, people take over. Some vasopressors that are used in ACLS, this is must know. 2010 AHA guidelines, they de-emphasize use of medications. They don't place stress on medicines much. They only say compressions. Quality, uninterrupted chest compressions and defibrillation. They say most vital, these things, not the medicines. But however, some medicines are used in resuscitation protocols. Epinephrine has been mainstay for a long time. Clinical evidence is lacking for improved survival and neurological recovery after cardiac arrest. Though not much, clinical evidence is not much in favor, but still it is being used. Other medicines are vasopressin and amiodarone. They are two other pharmacological agents commonly administered during cardiac arrest. Vasopressin and amiodarone lack convincing clinical evidence of improved hospital discharge and neurological recovery. All these three medicines, epinephrine, vasopressin, amiodarone use, they have demonstrated benefit only in ROS, that is, patient may get return of spontaneous circulation, but hospital discharge and neurological recovery, they are not benefited much. Patient may at best may become conscious and further management is required. Epinephrine, adrenaline, a few words about epinephrine. Epinephrine has potent alpha and beta adrenergic stimulation effects. It is administered as 1 milligram. It comes as 1 ml ampule containing 1 milligram. it is diluted to 10 ml of 1 in 10,000 solution IV dose. During resuscitation, 1 mg IV nephrectomy should be administered as initial pharmacological drug in ventricular fibrillation and PVT. This is the only drug mainstay. This can be repeated every 3 to 5 minutes as long as cardiac arrest persists. Epinephrine defibrillation. Defibrillation should be attempted 2 minutes after epinephrine. Which alpha 1 and alpha 2 receptor stimulation results in peripheral vasoconstriction, leading to increased aortic diastolic pressure. When aortic diastolic pressure improves, coronary blood flow also improves. Vasopressin, it is 40 units IV. It was included in previous resuscitation guidelines. It is an endogenous peptide hormone secreted by posterior pituitary gland in response to hypovolemia or systemic hypoperfusion states. This also produces peripheral vasoconstriction resulting from stimulation of V1 receptors in the endothelium. No survival benefit has been observed in humans when vasopressin was used with or without epinephrine in cardiac arrest. So the use of vasopressin is substitution of one dose of IV epinephrine with 40 units IV vasopressin during resuscitative efforts in cardiac arrest is acceptable. At least first you use the epinephrine one dose, next you can use either epinephrine or vasopressin, only one dose, and subsequently you continue using epinephrine. Amiodarone, it was included in ACLS algorithm because of its ability to terminate ventricular arrhythmias during cardiac arrest that were resistant to defibrillation after epinephrine administration. If ventricular resistant to defibrillation attempt, 300 milligrams IV amiodarone should be considered, and it can be repeated at 5-minute intervals on 50. If they want to. So the amiodarone first dose is 300 milligrams IV, then it can be repeated once at 5-minute periods with 150, half the dose. As with epinephrine, defibrillation should be attempted 2 minutes after amiodarone. Then amiodarone, as I already told you, like epinephrine, it improves the rate of ROS, that is return of spontaneous circulation. It has no observed benefit on hospital discharge or neurological outcomes. So this is important slide. Pulseless electrical activity. Pulseless electrical activity refers to a heterogeneous group of cardiac rhythm disorders. The common feature of all this is pulselessness in the presence of organized electrical activity. ECG, it shows normal ECG, but there is no pulse, no pumping of blood. That is why it is called pulseless electrical activity. Electrical activity is there, but there is no pulse. Pulse means heart is not pumping blood. So these conditions, high priority must be given into identifying possible reversible causes. Some of these causes are reversible. If they are attended, the patient gets corrected. The assessment of the 5 H's and 5 T's, these are grouped in 2 groups. 5 H's, hypovolemia, hypoxia, hydrogen ion acidosis, hypokalemia, hyperkalemia, hypothermia. These 5, they can produce a state of pulseless electrical activity. 5 T's are there: tension pneumothorax, cardiac tamponade, toxins, overdose of drugs like digitalis, beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, tricyclic antidepressants, pulmonary thromboembolism or air emboli, coronary thrombosis, that is acute myocardial infarction, we call it. For these things, initially what to do is initiation of chest compressions and administration of 1 mg of epinephrine are recommended until more definitive therapy can be provided. First you have to start with this, because the patient has to be revived, resuscitated. Then in the intervening period, you assess what is the cause and find out what the cause and institute appropriate therapy. Asystole or ventricular fibrillation can develop if PE is not corrected. If this is not corrected immediately, the patient goes to asystole, complete stoppage of the heart. That is very difficult to resuscitate. So this is asystole. There is not much here to discuss. It is complete and sustained absence of electrical activity. It is often a terminal event. In most patients, asystole is irreversible. However, a brief trial of resuscitation can be done, beginning with oxygen therapy, IV epinephrine, effective chest compressions. The mainstay everywhere is compressions, epinephrine, and oxygen. The concept that asystole is actually ventricular fibrillation is unrealistic. Atropine, previously they used to recommend for this, but it is nowadays not recommended for treating asystole. Then post resuscitation, there are certain interventions to be done. Supposing after the patient regains consciousness, rose out of hospital cardiac arrest, emergency percutaneous coronary intervention and angiography. This is because approximately 90% of patients resuscitated from out of hospital cardiac arrest. That is, a patient had a cardiac arrest outside the hospital. All these BLS, ACLS protocols done and he was resuscitated. And it is seen that they have coronary artery disease, heart disease. And 70% have at least one significant coronary lesion by coronary angiography. So that is why it is recommended that a percutaneous coronary intervention is undertaken. Early coronary intervention that re-established coronary blood flow improves myocardial recovery. And this is also should be considered for survivors of cardiac arrest as part of an advanced post cardiac arrest protocol. And for those who remain comatose after resuscitation, some people do not regain consciousness. In spite of doing all this, they remain comatose. And for them also, you may have to consider these things. Targeted temperature management is another important support therapy. The majority of patients dying after successful ROS die from ischemic neurologic injury. In normothermic individuals, cerebral blood flow less than 125 ml per minute and persisting for longer than 70 minutes is associated with permanent neurologic damage. In this setting, drugs are ineffective. Neurologic outcomes, induced hypothermia has some benefit. It might reduce cerebral metabolic rate and oxygen consumption, or as well as attenuate cerebral ischemia, induced inflammatory response. 2010 AHA guidelines recommend induced core body temperatures. This is important. 32 degrees to 34 degrees centigrade over 12 to 24 hours. This is recommended for patients who are hemodynamically stable, whose pulse and BP is stable, and they are resuscitated from ventricular fibrillation or pulseless ventricular tachycardia, but they remain comatose. These things can be done by a team of healthcare providers who are familiar with induced hypothermia. And for inducing induced hypothermia, patients need to be put under sedation, neuromuscular blockade, and mechanical ventilation. During this induced hypothermia, patients will get several complications like pneumonia, seizures, hyperglycemia, hypoglycemia, and several medicines also need to be used. So this is all possible only in advanced cardiac care centers, well-equipped teams, supported by all these facilities wherever available, only there this can be done. Post-resuscitation oxygen therapy, I worried about it. Whether increased arterial oxygen concentration during ROS harmful to ischemic cells, particularly neurons, and a lower inspired oxygen concentration be provided. This was one recommendation. Annual studies have demonstrated improved survival after hypoxic and ischemic episodes when low rather than high arterial oxygen concentrations are used. Oxygen should not match, higher rates of oxygen should not be used. But no human studies have demonstrated clear evidence that hyperoxia must be avoided. But hypoxia must be avoided at all. It offers no, hyperoxia doesn't offer any benefit. Hypoxia is clearly harmful. So, but the recommendation is 2010 AHA guidelines, they recommend an approach for managing survivors of cardiac arrest, titrating oxygen therapy to attain oxygen saturation 94 to 98% with the variable continuous pulse oximetry. The oxygen requirement, the level of oxygen is, should be titrated. You use only that much, which gives you 94 to 98% saturation with pulse oximeter. So this is the recommendation given by AHA. These things I've already discussed. I will discuss only main CPR quality. A few points are discussed. Push hard, 5 centimeters depth, fast, hard and fast. Allow complete chest recoil. Minimize interruptions in compressions. Avoid excessive ventilation. Rotate compressor every 2 minutes. If there is no advanced airway, 30 to 20 compressions, ventilation ratio. Quantitative waveform capnography. End tidal carbon dioxide, if it is less than 10, it indicates CPR quality is poor, compression is not proper, you have to improve that. It also is measured by intra-arterial pressure. If relaxation phase diastolic pressure, if it is less than 20, you should attempt to improve CPR quality. These things only in advanced centers we can measure. Drug therapy, I have already told, epinephrine, either IV, intravenous or intraosseous. Intraosseous is used when IV is not accessible in children. 1 milligram every 3 to 5 minutes. Vasopressin, it also can be given IV or intraosseous, 40 units. It can replace first or second dose of epinephrine. Only once it can be given. Amiodarone, IV, IO, first dose 300, second is 150. Advanced airway, supraglottic advanced airway or endotracheal intubation. Waveform capnography to confirm and monitor endotracheal tube placement. That is PTCO to monitor end-tidal carbon dioxide, I told you. 8 to 10 breaths per minute with continuous chest compressions. Return of spontaneous circulation. This you check by pulsing and blood pressure. If the equipment is available, sustained increase in PETCO2, end-tidal carbon dioxide, if it is greater than 40, sudden rise indicates patient has recovered. And if there is hemodynamic monitoring, that is an arterial catheter, if it is there, you can see spontaneous arterial pressure waves, but this is in advanced place only. This shock energy, I've already told, biphasic manufacturer recommendation, initial dose of 120 to 200 joules, biphasic defibrillators. If you don't know, use maximum available. Second and subsequent doses should be equivalent, and high doses may be considered. If it is monophasic, 360 joules. These 5 Hs and 5 Ts I have already told. Post cardiac arrest care, these also not much we have discussed. Thank you. Now,
First step of BLS is assessment and scene safety. The first rescuer who arrives at the side of the victim must quickly be sure that the scene is safe. The rescuer should then assess the victim for a response and breathing.
Hey, hey, are you okay? Can you hear me? He isn't responding. Isn't breathing normally, just gasping. Grab the AED.
If the rescuer is alone, he or she would then call for help and get the AED. The next step is to check for a pulse. To perform a pulse check in the adult, feel for a carotid pulse.
No pulse.
This technique is usually easier to perform on the side nearer the rescuer. Locate the trachea using two or three fingers. Slide these fingers into the groove between the trachea and the muscles at the side of the neck, where you can feel the carotid pulse. Perform the pulse check for at least 5 seconds and no more than 10 seconds. If you do not definitely feel a pulse, immediately begin CPR, starting with chest compressions, CAB sequence. On any given day, you could come across a victim of cardiac arrest, where your actions and training can determine the outcome. Today, we'll review the key elements of providing basic life support to adults, children, and infants. This will include both CPR skills and AED use, as well as how to help a victim who is choking, and a discussion of special considerations. High-quality CPR improves a victim's chances of survival. There are several critical elements of high-quality CPR you should remember. Start compressions within 10 seconds of recognition of cardiac arrest. Push hard, push fast. Provide compressions at a rate of at least 100 compressions per minute and at a depth of at least 2 inches or 5 centimeters for adults. Allow complete chest recoil after each compression. Minimize interruptions. Try to limit interruptions in compressions to less than 10 seconds. Give effective breaths that make the chest rise. Avoid excessive ventilation.
There's no pulse. 1, 2, 3.
CPR begins with compressions. Because compressions are so important to a victim's survival, they need to be started immediately, within 10 seconds of recognition of cardiac arrest. Early CPR keeps the oxygen and blood flowing to the heart and brain, creating valuable life-saving time until spontaneous circulation is restored.
1, 2.
To be most effective, CPR should be performed as a team with rescuers completing many tasks simultaneously. However, in order to be an effective team member, you need to master the individual skills of one rescuer CPR.
Let's switch now.
For this training, we will isolate the individual skills rescuers perform and then put them together, so you'll be prepared to deliver high-quality CPR and use an AED as a team. Okay, now it's time for you to practice all of the One Rescuer BLS skills together.
Hey, hey, are you okay? Activate the emergency response, grab the AED. One, two, three, four. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30.
We've covered everything you need to know to recognize cardiac arrest and perform single rescue or CPR. For some healthcare providers and other rescuers, a two-person or team rescue is far more common. In two rescuer CPR, each rescuer has a specific role. Rescuer 1 should be positioned at the victim's side. It is Rescuer 1's role to perform chest compressions, counting out loud.
1, 2, 3, 4.
You have already learned the proper technique for compressions.
9, 10.
Rescuer 2 should be positioned at the victim's head. It is Rescuer 2's role to maintain an open airway and give breaths with a bag mask while watching for chest rise and avoiding excessive ventilation. Rescuer 2 should also encourage Rescuer 1 to perform chest compressions that are fast and deep enough and to allow complete chest recoil between compressions.
7, 8.
Remember, push hard and fast, at least 2 inches or 5 centimeters. His chest needs to fully recoil between compressions.
5, 26, 27, 20.
As you are aware by now, giving good compressions can be very tiring. So in a two-person rescue scenario, it's important to switch roles about every 2 minutes to prevent fatigue. Every time the AED tells you to reanalyze, switch roles. If there is no AED present, switch roles after every 5 cycles of CPR. Now you know how to perform two-person rescue. But let's review some key points. The first rescuer performs chest compressions and counts out loud. The second rescuer maintains the open airway and gives breaths. The compression rate for two rescuer CPR is at least 100 compressions per minute. The compression ventilation ratio for adults is 30 to 2. Compression should be paused when giving breaths until an advanced airway is in place. When performing CPR without an AED, rescuers switch roles about every 5 cycles to prevent fatigue. When an AED is present, switch roles every time the AED tells you to reanalyze. This switch should take less than 5 seconds, minimizing hands-off time. The rescuer giving breaths must monitor the chest compressions that are being delivered, encourage the compressing rescuer to push at an adequate rate and depth, and allow complete chest recoil after each compression. Now we're going to pause the video to allow you to ask questions and prepare for the next section of the course, defibrillation.
It's through. Everybody step back, please. Scene is safe. We can take it from here, sir.
Well, you guys got here quick.
Hey, can you hear me? Are you okay? He's not responding. He's not breathing normally, just gasping. Grab the AED. There's no pulse. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14.
His chest needs to completely recoil after each compression.
21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28.
Analyze.
Everybody clear?
Heart rhythm. Do not touch the patient.
Let's switch now.
Shock needed. Charging. Stay clear.
AED says
patient.
Shock advised. Everybody
press
clear?
The flashing button now. Shock delivered. Begin CPR.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28. Let's switch again.
Shock needed. Stay clear of patient. Charging. Press the flashing
everybody clear
button now. Shock delivered. Begin CPR.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30.
He's breathing, and it's normal.
There's a pulse.
Let's get ready to transport.
There's no pulse.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Remember,
five, six,
push hard seven, and fast.
Eight, nine,
at least
ten,
2 inches seven, or five 12, centimeters.
13, 14,
his chest
15,
needs to 16, completely 16, recoil 16, after each 16, compression.
22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28.
Analyze.
Everybody clear?
Rhythm. Do not touch the patient.
Although AEDs may differ slightly, there are four universal steps for operating an AED. First, turn on the AED. Open the carrying case or the top of the AED, then turn the power on. Some devices will power on automatically when you open the lid. The AED will guide you, but it's still critically important that you know these steps. Some AEDs may have adult and pediatric pads. Make sure you use the adult pads on anyone 8 years of age and older. Peel away the backing from the pads. Following the pictures found on the pads, attach the adhesive pads to the victim's bare chest. Place one pad to the side of the left nipple. Place the other pad on the victim's upper right chest, directly below the collarbone. If instructed by the AED, clear the victim and analyze the rhythm.
11,
analyzing
12.
Heart rhythm. Do not touch
analyzing.
The patient.
Let's switch.
Shock needed. Charging. Stay clear of patient. Press the flashing
button. Shock advised. Clear.
Be sure that no one is touching the victim, not even the person in charge of giving breaths. Ideally, you will pause CPR during or immediately after a set of compressions. Some AEDs will tell you to push a button to allow the AED to analyze the heart rhythm. Others will do that automatically. The AED may take about 5 to 15 seconds to analyze the rhythm. The AED then tells you if a shock is needed. If the AED recommends a shock, it will tell you to clear the victim and push the shock button. Again, be sure no one is touching the victim to avoid injury to rescuers. Then loudly state a clear the victim message. It can be something like, everybody's clear, or simply, clear. Perform a visual check to ensure that no one is in contact with the victim.
Shock advised, clear.
Press the shock button. The shock may produce a sudden contraction of the victim's muscles. As soon as the AED gives the shock, immediately resume CPR, beginning with chest compressions. Do not remove the AED or turn it off. The AED will repeat the analyze and shock cycle every 2 minutes.
No shock needed.
When the AED indicates no shock advised, you do not check the pulse first, you immediately start chest compressions again. There are also some special situations you'll need to consider when using an AED. If a victim has hair on his chest, the hair may prevent the pads from sticking. The AED may tell you to check the pads. If this happens, press the pads down more firmly. If they still aren't sticking, rip the pads off forcefully, removing the chest hair. Then reapply a new set of pads to the bare skin. If your AED supply kit has a razor, you can use this to shave the area as well, and then reapply a new set of pads. Water on the victim's chest could allow the shock to travel through the water between the pads and prevent delivery of an effective shock dose to the victim's heart. If someone is lying in water, you should quickly move the victim to a dry area. If the victim is lying on snow or in a small puddle, you may use the AED. If the chest is covered with water or sweat, wipe the chest before attaching the AED pads. But wipe the chest quickly, as it doesn't have to be completely dry. Some people have implanted pacemakers and/or defibrillators in the same place where you would put the AED pads. The device will look like a round or square lump, smaller than a deck of cards. If you see this lump, try to avoid putting the pad directly over the lump. Do not place the pad directly over a medicine patch. If the shock delivery will not be delayed, take the patch off and quickly wipe the chest before you put on the pad. We've talked about the differences in compressions and breaths for children and infants. But now let's cover the difference in the use of an AED for an infant or child under 8 years of age. Some AEDs have been modified to deliver different shock doses, one shock dose for adults and one for children under 8. If you use a pediatric-capable AED, there are features that allow it to deliver the child-appropriate shock. Which feature is available depends on the type of AED you are using. If your AED includes a smaller size pad designed for children, use it. If not, use the standard pads, making sure they do not touch or overlap. The important thing is to be familiar with the AED you will be using, if possible, before you actually need to use it. When you are using an AED, remember to turn it on first and follow the prompts as it leads you through the rest of the steps. For infants, a manual defibrillator is preferred to an AED for defibrillation. If a manual defibrillator is not available, an AED equipped with a pediatric dose attenuator is preferred. If neither is available, you may use an AED without a pediatric dose attenuator.
Well, hey, Scott.
Hey, Sam. How you doing?
I'm looking forward to a few days of not being on call.
I didn't think you ever needed rest.
Oh, I'm not resting. I've got my whole family coming into town this weekend, and they're expecting me to provide the entertainment. What's wrong?
I think he's choking. Are you choking? I'm going to help you. Sit down.
Choking occurs when food or other items block a person's airway. In severe airway obstructions, the victim usually will have signs of poor air exchange and breathing difficulty, such as a silent cough, cyanosis or turning blue, and an inability to speak or breathe. The adult or older child may clutch the neck with both hands, making the universal choking sign. This is a signal to ask if the victim is choking. If the victim nods that he or she is choking and cannot talk, you must act. In a standing or kneeling victim, you'll perform an abdominal thrust often referred to as the Heimlich maneuver. Stand or kneel behind the victim and place your arms around the victim's waist. With one hand, locate the navel. Then make a fist with the other hand. Place the thumb side of your fist against the victim's abdomen, just above the navel and below the breastbone. Grasp your fist with your other hand and press your fist into the victim's abdomen with a quick, forceful upward thrust. Repeat thrusts until the object is expelled from the airway or the victim becomes unresponsive. If the victim is too large for you to wrap your arms around the waist, pregnant or overweight, for example, wrap your arms around the victim's chest and do chest thrusts instead of abdominal thrusts. If your attempts to relieve choking in an adult or child are unsuccessful or the victim becomes unresponsive, send someone to activate the emergency response system. Perform CPR using the CAB sequence with one exception. Each time you open the airway to give breaths, look for the obstructing object in the back of the throat. If you see an object that can be easily removed, Carefully remove it, but do not perform a blind finger sweep as the object may become lodged further back in the airway. Choking is also a fairly common emergency among infants. The steps to relieving choking in an infant are quite different than those for older children and adults. If you find an infant choking and they are responsive, first sit or kneel with the infant in your lap. Hold the infant face down with the head slightly lower than the chest, resting on your forearm. Support the head and jaw with your hand. Avoid compressing the soft tissues of the infant's throat. Rest your forearm on your thigh to provide support. Deliver up to 5 back slaps forcefully between the infant's shoulder blades using the heel of your hand. Deliver each slap with sufficient force to attempt to remove the foreign body. Then place your free hand on the infant's back, supporting the head with the palm of your hand. This will cradle the infant between your two forearms as you turn the infant over while carefully supporting the head and neck. Keep the infant's head lower than the chest and deliver up to 5 quick downward chest thrusts the same way you perform compressions, just below the nipple line, over the lower half of the breastbone. Do this at a rate of about 1 per second. Repeat the sequence of 5 back slaps and 5 chest thrusts until the object is removed or the infant becomes unresponsive. As with an adult, if a choking infant becomes unresponsive, shout for help. Then lay the infant on a hard, flat surface. Perform CPR with one exception. Each time you open the airway to give breaths, look for the obstructing object in the back of the throat. Chest compressions may help move the object so you can remove it. Once you can see the object, carefully try to remove it. Never perform a blind finger sweep. You only want to sweep for an object if you can see it. If you are alone, after about 2 minutes or 5 cycles of CPR, activate the emergency response system.
We are closing the session. Third video, I think it will take time, so I'm not showing it. Thank you.